We seem to have three papers here this afternoon. I'm not sure if the last one is here or not. Oh, you're here. Okay, so let's get started. We're already running more than half an hour behind schedule. So our first presenter, Jana Nistor, PhD student from this department, so please.
Hello, my name is Diana Nistor, and I will. Firstly, I would like to say something about my work. So, I'm a PhD student here in Cluj-Napoca, and my PhD thesis tries to cover the migrations of the Roma during the communist regime here in Transylvania, but this is not the topic I will talk about today. This presentation today is about my. The challenges of my fieldwork research, so the challenges I encountered, me and my colleagues encountered during the fieldwork campaigns last year, and also its, let's say, metamorphosis because of that, let's call them not that successful approaches in some communities and families. Before I went to do oral history interviews within Roma in Romania, I was always accustomed to doing oral history and with its methodology. I have had over 20 interviews with Romanians and Hungarians here, and I was very daring and eager to do some more. The first questions that came to mind before the fieldwork campaigns were how should I approach the Roma communities, whom to talk to first, how should I call them, gypsies or Roma, if I might bring any gifts, or what happened if they refuse to talk to me or to be recorded, and should I insist, how much should I insist on it, and questions. We thought of different ways of approaching Roma communities, and finally we used them all, depending on the community. We used the contact person, which really seemed the easier way to get closer to Roma and obtain interviews. We entered the communities by ourselves, explaining to the people our purposes and doing interviews that way. And also we received references from the interviewed people to go to some of their acquaintances and or relatives. I can say that there is no better way of approaching the Roma community. It depends on how they were used or not used to talk to people. For instance, in the Cortorari, so coppersmiths Roma communities, they were very. Somehow they were used to talk to researchers because there were a lot of anthropologists doing field work there, and they knew exactly how to behave and what to tell us and so on. So it was a little hard to go beyond what they were used to do before we got there. Our first attempt in getting closer to a Roma community was in Sighișoara, and we talked with an informal leader of theirs, and also who also works at the city hall with the Roma minority, and he introduced us to some Roma families in Sighișoara and Șoar. This is a nearby village of Sighișoara, where we had some interviews, but let's say we weren't that pleased with the way we managed to enter the community and the way we interacted with Roma from there. Another attempt to enrich Roma communities was in Sibiu County, where we contacted the president of the Romani party, so Partida Romilor, Romanian, who called a friend of his, a Cortorar Roma, and literally instructed him to friendly welcome us and help us with our needs. In fact, this was let's say one of our most fruitful campaigns fieldwork campaigns that we had last year, and we were in those villages twice. The families were very open, and they recommended us to their families and their relatives, and we went in different places, so different villages from city within the coppersmith communities. On our fieldwork campaign within the Gabori Roma community in Mureș County, in Crăciunești, we went for the second method. So we were walking on the streets and asked people if they wanted to talk to us or and to give us interviews. So Crăciunești is a village in I don't think I have a picture, but later on I will have one. It's a village dwelled almost entirely by Gabor community, and well, we were knocking from door to door trying to get someone to talk to us. It was at some point we were hopeless, but finally we had some well, extraordinary interviews there. Should I stay or should I go? These are the lyrics from a song you, I guess, everyone has in his mind now. These were also the questions I used to ask myself so many times during the fieldwork campaigns. I met people who refused to be interviewed and said it from the very beginning that they are not interested. They didn't want to told us anything. They do not have something interesting to say to us. So. And this was it. Well, I tried to talk them and to talk to them and to explain them how important their stories are to us and to their history, so the Roma history, which hasn't been written till or hasn't been written their stories in it wasn't written before, and I tried, and in particular to manage to convince them to talk to us, but well, it sometimes worked, sometimes it didn't. In some cases, people said they are not interested in Roma history, but they would help me with my needs, and if I had to write a book or something, they would help me. So next time I was in the community, I explained them. I was a PhD student. I wanted to write something about their history, so I needed their help. When they heard I needed their help, they would say, "Yes, okay, I will help you with this, and let's go for it." Okay, there was. The very short interview and the very long interview. There were interviewees who answered very quickly to my questions, even though I tried to ask open questions. They were like, "I don't remember," or "I don't know," or it was very, very, very nice back then, but that's all. And the interview was going like this. I had, for instance, an interview with a young lady, a 3-minute interview. I must recognize it was one of my awful interviews. She was young, as I told you. I asked her if she does remember. She didn't remember when she was born. Well, I guess I got past, and I asked her if she remembered her childhood being so young. I assumed she would definitely say something about her childhood, but she didn't. So I stopped the interview, I interrupted the interview, and, well, gave up somehow. But I had the very long interview with a 93-year-old blacksmith from Mureș County, who talked for like 3 hours about his experience in the Second World War. And during the Second World War, and he didn't stop, so it was like 3 long hours when I was wondering myself, should I stop him and schedule another interview on the other day, or should I listen to him and he will decide at some point to stop and maybe continue in another day. But at some point I interrupted him, and he agreed to see me again next day, and we were for the third time at his place and took another 3 hours interview with him, and he was absolutely great at everything. So meeting the Gabor. I remember it was the hottest day of the last summer, and me, Ionela, Cristi and Lavi Lavinia with her son were walking around the main street of Crăciunești, which was the village dwelt by Gabor, trying to convince someone to talk to us. Finally, we knocked at the home of a Gabor family. The young lady, the child, but she was maybe 28 years old and something like that. She promised us that their parents, so her parents will talk to us and will give us an interview. So we went there, we knocked at the door, and they were like, okay, they looked at us, and finally they looked at Milan being Lavinia's son. And they welcome us because they needed to feed Milan and to give him water and some
6 months. And
yeah,
he didn't really eat meat.
Yes. So we were welcomed in this way. We entered the room and stood there for like 30 minutes, very long 30 minutes, when they ignored us. Well, not Milan, but us. So I kept wondering myself, should we go now? Because there was nothing, I don't know, happening. So I didn't see the interview coming at some point. But finally, in the end, we had a wonderful, one of the most interesting interviews within the Gabor community. Okay, coffee time. I'm going to discuss a little bit about the hospitality of Roma. I met last year, and I must recognize they really impressed me with the way where Roma received us, and even though they never met us before. So in order to give an explanation to their hospitality, I might assume that maybe welcoming a gage would mean, or it is welcoming of a gage is some kind of their part of their culture or a pride in itself, because it happened more than once that our interviewee told their for instance, their neighbors that we were their friends from Cluj visiting them. So it definitely was a pride in there. It frequently happened to me that I have to drink or eat something before the interview. So maybe it's somehow understandable as long as they do not know me before, so we had to chit chat a little bit before the interview. But on the other hand, more than once, even though I didn't want to eat or drink anything, well, I had to because I couldn't refuse. Once, though, it happened to me that I didn't taste the cookies a woman put on the table, and I really felt very bad about it, because in the end she told me that maybe I was disgusted by, I don't know, eating from gypsies. It was a bad behavior I had. Oh, and also we ate lunches, dinners, and coffees, and teas, and so on. But I got some once a sachet of eggs and cheese and pork fat, because the lady whom I interviewed said that if you don't live with your parents anymore, you might need this food. So yes, I had to take the sachet and go home. I remember also when we were in Huedin at the Gabors again, a woman asked us, me and Ionela, if we would like a coffee. And well, by the time I was preparing to say that I don't drink coffee, she came back with two packages of Lavazza coffee and gave us. So we were like holding more coffees in our hands, and that was it. Even though the oral history interviews had some cardinal rules, I learned that not all interviews can be conducted as such. So in many of my interviews I took within Roma communities broke this rule. It is the interviewer's duty to make the environment, well, let's say appropriate for the interview, to for the recording, but sometimes sometimes I was, I don't know, constrained to pass by all these uncomfortable environments or the people who were interrupting the main interviewee in order to have that interview in the end. So for instance, all the interviews I had within the Cortorar communities, there is a photo from the Cortorar community, so the coppersmiths, and in on the right hand, the interview I had with the Gabor woman. Well, for instance, all the interviews I had within the Cortorar are multiple interviews, so recording the entire family, talking about the same subject, most of the times at the same time, but you cannot do anything about this, so it's unfortunately, it makes sometimes the interview, the main interviewee's memory, it's disturbed by it, and on the other hand, well, the transcription is very hard to do in the end. Talking about uncomfortable environments, I give, so this is the photo me getting dressed as a Cortorar lady in Mergindial, Sibiu County. Talking about uncomfortable environments, I could give a lot of examples when I couldn't focus on my interviewee's testimony, because, for instance, I had a turkey climbing on my back, or a lot of bugs were marching on my feet, or there were caterpillars falling from the trees under which I've conducted the interviews. So I could give, I don't know, maybe more examples, but still, and those were the trees. Those are the trees, with the entire population of caterpillars from Romania, in Dordania, southern Romania. So, when I first went to do interviews within Roma, I avoided using the terms gypsies or Roma for fear of not offending anyone, because I wasn't sure if they would like to be called gypsies or not. My first interviews didn't contain any words of gypsies or Roma, but I used your community, or the community we're talking about. Well, it was obvious I am talking about the gypsy community. So afterwards we introduced some questions in the interview guide, and we used, yes, I'll finish as quickly as I can. And we use some questions to see whether they like to call themselves gypsy, or us to call them gypsies, or Roma, or Gabor, or Cortorar, or how they like to call them. So in most of the cases, they were not bothered at all to be called gypsies, but and the Gabor would prefer, still, they would prefer Gabor, the Cortorar would prefer coppersmith or Cortorar, and so on. There were interviews which turned out to be into very nice discussions, and here Ionela tackled this particular thing from our interviews when we heard so many secrets, well, unfortunately recorded secrets, and yeah, we have to deal with them now. About the gifts, and that's all. About the gifts. I was used to give at the end of the interview to my interviewees, even though they were Romanians or Hungarians or whatever, a chocolate at the end, as a, I don't know, thank you. And I considered it to do very okay to do it the same within the Roma. We did that almost all the cases, but there were communities where we were advised not to do so, so we didn't. So this gift given by us at the end of the interview, I don't think that affected in any way the interview itself or the relationship created between the interviewer and the interviewee. So it's irrelevant or redundant or, yeah. And after all, doing oral history interviews within Roma communities in Romania provide the researcher, so me, with different experiences. So from one community to another one, from one house to another one, they are different. They are completely different. Well, they are different people, so of course they would be different. And also, that's why I could say that crossing thresholds toward Roma communities in Romania helped me improve my doing oral history techniques. And I started doing, for instance, fieldwork notes, as they look quite the same as the anthropologist ones. But and Sanziana, our colleague, who is kind of she told me that I should do that, and it helped me very, very much with my research concerning dwelling conditions. So yes, in the end, I learned a lot of things during these fieldwork campaigns, and most of all, to have patience and more patience and a lot of patience. So thank you very much. And if one of my colleagues who were on the field has something to add, because there were a lot of interesting things to tell, please feel free to do so. Thank you.
So questions? I was just thinking about this very short interview you had.
The three minutes.
What was your interpretation of it? Was she just not interested in history, or did she have some reservations about talking to you in particular? I don't know.
I thought she was maybe ashamed of something. I don't know. She had like three little children around her, and I don't know, maybe she didn't want to talk to me or something like that, because in fact we were close ages, which she was like, I guess, 22 or 21. I might assume she would have done something about, I don't know, her life, her, the community she was living in or something, but she didn't. I don't know, I didn't interpret really this interview, because maybe she really didn't want to talk to me at all. I don't know.
And because you mentioned that you get experience in interviewing Romanians from various other ethnicities, do you at the end find it different to approach? Because, you know, sometimes I think that also the researchers, not you, but sometimes researchers who haven't worked with Roma would assume, you know, they're really exotic or there's some particular thing about them. But at the end, because everything you described, actually, my field research in Montenegro, for example, for my PhD, is among Montenegro, Serbians, Muslims, Albanians. So I had to have lunch a couple of times per day because, you know, I mean, this kind of open hospitality or, you know, wish to feed you and to welcome you and to make you feel better and so on, it's so common. So do you at the end consider that there's something different?
So after all, the Romanians were different from the Hungarians. The Hungarians were different from Roma. So I guess each family has its particular way of living.
More individual,
of talking with.
And just out of curiosity, why did they advise you not to give the chocolate? Because I think it's
this happens to us. Yeah.
We could say we had some kind of another bad experience in Oman. When we did that, when we took interviews, it was a bit awkward because we went with the local I don't know what it is, vice mayor, something like that, and he was quite abusive. And he talked to them in a racist manner. He said, you stay here, you talk to him. He already got into the community, he was ordering everybody. It was quite awkward, and it was really weird for us. And we did this. We took interviews with people, everything was nice. We went with the protocol, we gave everyone all we had, chocolate, waffles, coffee. And after that, when he left, the vice mayor has left. And as we were leaving, as we were done with the interviews, people were still coming to give us interviews. People were not related. They were 15 years. They were coming for the chocolate.
Only for the chocolate.
So they were really not interested. They were like, when you were said, let's do the interview, it was like 5 minutes. Okay.
in order to get
so
the gift.
Yeah. But I believe the vice mayor was the fault, mm-hmm. was not the people, and he did this, he presented us in a very bad way, and it was quite, it was one of the bad experiences we had.
I spent a lot of my time during the summer in the Roma communities in some villages. And when she was talking, I know myself the thing with the gift that there are two possibilities, but before this, that if you give them something, they will think that maybe you give them because you think they don't have it, or they cannot have the money to buy it. Or the second possibility is that if you give something to them, the news will spread in the whole village, and then all the kids will come around you.
Yeah.
Well, then you add this.
We had a strategy as well. We had some chocolate, some candies, usually reserved
for the children from the village.
Yeah. So we were prepared about this. It will happen. It doesn't matter if they're Roma, Romanian,
they're
children.
Everyone likes
exactly.
Sweets. Yeah.
So, but this particular village, Loman, it was quite. There was a really big difference between the Romanian community and the Gypsy community, because Romanian during the communist era, Roma and Romanian were having the same standard of living, and after the fall of communism, Romanians got really rich. And the Roma remained poor or even poorer. Lately they got poorer because they were working on, you know, factory down in Sebeș, and they had a bus on the route that was taking them to work, but there was a downsize at the factory, so they didn't pay the bus anymore to come all the way to them, and they didn't afford to go all the way down to the town. And this community was quite poor. Literally speaking, there were no roads, and getting in the village during the winter time, that was my big question, it was impossible to just come out of the house and go buy bread or something, because there was no shops or anything inside the Roma community. They were in some kind of a desert valley when nobody got there, they were just the Roma. I believe Schwart was one of the poorest villages we have been, but Roman, from all the villages I have been, was the worst case.
Or Lișteava
was quite parted, because, yeah, the brick makers.
Yes,
yeah, but the brick makers were a few, just a hand of families, but Roman was the whole community.
Yeah, that's true.
In really big trouble. And the particularity was that compared to Lișteava, where they were going to work in Italy or Spain, in Domani they were going nowhere. They were just there.
Right, but the ones in Domani, they didn't have any access to information whatsoever.
Yeah.
Also, their contact with the Romanians from the village was very limited. And for example, one of my interviewees told me that there were cases when the Romanians beat up the Roma without any particular reason, just because they were Roma. So basically, the Roma were afraid of the Romanians. So
I believe it's the only case we have met with this direct explanation that Romanians are beating the Roma for no particular reason. There was no other village that someone could say that. They usually said they were getting along with Romanians, but here it was a clear division.
So they would say that those who did the beating up were shepherds who usually got drunk, and after that they were looking for trouble. So if they saw a Roma, so it was like the victim.
Mm-hmm. And as the vice mayor was behaving, it was quite disgusting, really annoying. Because I think we better have went by ourselves in the communities,
mm-hmm.
and probably would have got better interviews. So most of the times it's better to not have a contact.
Yeah, that's
contact.
What I wanted to say, because we had the experiences were more fruitful when we didn't have a contact.
Yeah.
But probably the exception is
Mr.
Gheorghe.
Yes,
he was a Roma one of a kind who had the patience to take us everywhere and to stay. which was quite unusual, because he would say, look, it's important to share your story, it's important for your grandchildren to know how your life has been. So just share your story freely because they are friends and I trust them. So basically that was it. He trusted us. So.
Okay. I think we need to move on. Thank you very much, Dana.
I have no presentation, no
okay.
PowerPoint.
Okay, so
I'll speak from my...
Yes, page. This is Petcuţ, Roma scholar residing in Paris.
Yes.
So, please.
Thank you. First of all, English is not my working language, so patient in Paris or near Paris. I meet Roma in their bidonville, in their camps. You can find more information about these places in the review, the article. So they are not home, and because they are not home, they are more suspicious. People who visit them. The first category are the local policemen, the cops, who list everyone. I was there once and I was listed too. like everybody. The second, because of the cops, another occasion, a Roma accused me that I'm undercover, that I work for the police. I know you. Yes, I know you. And 1 hour later, he did. You busted me. You arrested me once. I know. So it was difficult to explain to the others that I'm not a cop. The second category are the social workers who follow the community movement. And try to respond to some of his needs. There are women who
pregnant.
There are some kids who are sick, and the social workers try to respond. But these social workers, when they saw me, they were suspicious too, because the community are their job. If someone from outside come into the community to do something, they are not agree, because this is their work. If they exist because the community exists. If this problem will not be a problem in the future, they what they will do after that. Also, the local authorities from the city hall, came and are preoccupied by the garbage, by the water. And the last category are the journalists and the researchers. In this category, Roma put together journalists and researchers. Because the journalists and the researchers try to take to get their stories. So the people of the community believe that you will get a lot of money because you make an interview with him, and they try to get their parts. You make money with me. Where is my part? All of them believe that that I'm rich, that I have a lot of money, and if you give them nothing, they will say no. I have no time, because they are in France to make money. Each contact, each occasion is see like an opportunity. If you pay them, no problem with the number of the interviews. In some cases, I pay for their time. I paid them, and 2 hours or 3 hours, they accept to speak with me. A lot of them are occupied, are in the town to work, only 20% you will find home. Their location are all around Paris, so I must drive 1 hour to the camp. And another problem is that they change their phone number every month. Today they are in Paris, tomorrow in Germany, 2 days after that they are in Romania. They come back 1 month later. It's not it's a group who change location and phone number. So another problem is that they don't believe you. They don't believe your when you your motivation, and because of that they don't deliver you information, rich information, only poor information. They don't talk with you about money, how they make money, or they say I get 20 euros even if they if even if they get 60-70 euros a day, they don't like to talk about their trips in different countries, and they have some difficulties to talk about the places where they lived before. They make confusions. Women's not so many confusions, but the men's a lot of confusions. So when I try to identify the place where they lived before, I must go to search in the archives. Archives from the Tribunal de Grande Instance, where the judge pronounced the expulsions. But there is another problem. You must know the date exact, the date where the process took place. So if you know the date, okay, you will get the paper. If not, you can't do this. The last problem I saw there, when I tried to speak with the women, the women are available only if their husband give them this possibility, and I can talk with them if I pay them. If I pay the woman, this is in France the mentality. You want to talk with me during 2 hours, you must pay me. And in the future, I will try to focalize on the Seventh-day Adventist Roma, because I met them to the church, and it's another relationship between us. And if you have questions, I'll try to respond, but in Romania. Merci.
All right.
Are these things that you have met in Roma communities in Romania?
Some of them.
Yeah.
For example,
yeah.
The money issue.
Yeah.
But this is what I wanted to ask. Which communities are the Roma in Paris coming from? So what kind of number are they in Paris?
I'm Vazut. Rom din regiunea Brickmakers, din regiunea Segarcea.
From the southern part of Romania.
Ursari from Buzău.
That was the western, southwestern part.
Ursari from Craiova.
Because in certain communities we have encountered this problem systematically and united at all. The cortorar who practice begging as a profession, and they go abroad and make a lot of money on begging. It was in the beginning difficult to get in the community without paying, but after being, I mean, they were themselves motivated to speak, and the girls I think have done a great job in becoming friends with many ladies who used to beg abroad and make money this way. So we succeeded to get over this issue. It was another situation. In the interview, I spoke about in Xinjiang. I think that was Nick's worst experience with asking money. It was this gentleman who is a Holocaust survivor. He had the story, and there was an old lady who said she was a Holocaust survivor too, but she didn't say anything about her life in Transnistria. So we kind of, I mean, not even themselves were pretty convinced that she was a survivor. And in the end, she was asking almost aggressively money from us, yeah, while the other were kind of ashamed of the way she was...
Nani,
the young guy,
was telling her, they are not, he was talking to her in Romani, they are not kind, they will give you money, so stop, they're not here for to give money. She was not stopping, it was very annoying. So, besides the fact that during the whole interview, she interrupted constantly, and that was really annoying, and I couldn't...
Yeah, I think Nick had, anyway...
I couldn't get out of the interview somehow.
Anyway, yes, this happened. It was another situation in Lauda Lastrehaev community, yes, where I kind of was drunk, or I don't know what was wrong with me.
It was too hot
outside that I literally gave some money from not many interview, but we hope in the future we're gonna...
In that community, if you want to have free entry, you must give something. Mm-hmm. If not, you could get no problem.
Yeah, but after that, I was thinking we could use another strategy of co-interesting them in working with us, and I think the project, this idea, and Petre has to go back and do some project together with them, because they keep calling me and asking what is happening with our willingness of doing projects together. And I say, Petre is in France, when he comes back we're going to discuss something about this. There is a lot of potential. I mean, literally, they can do a lot on getting grants and developing projects. And there is a guy, he's a Roma, his name is Otto Mihai, he's young, he's in his 30s. He's... he's something... at the local council in Xinjiang, in that village we've been in. He's responsible for grants and projects at the local council, and he was really open, and I think he had the potential both to create and to implement projects for the Roma. But he was kind of highly discriminated, and his story, that we have an interview with him, and he was literally, I mean, if that would happen in Cluj, I think the entire press would have exploded. Yeah. Basically, the mayor of the town, the village, simply wanted to replace him in managing the project, just because that.
Yeah, or he won the project, and he won the project when he got the money, and when they had to name the team,
he was
the one who made the project, he was replaced on the last moment.
Very, very ugly stuff, yeah. Continuing, but still he is very enthusiastic, and he had found ways of surviving all through this situation, and he and a colleague of his, a non-Roma Romanian, they have created their own NGO, and they apply for project as NGO separately from the village council, and I bet he will be highly successful because he knows the community. He had an excellent reputation. He speaks Romani.
Yeah.
He is extremely nice. He brought us to his own family. We have great interview with his mother and his father.
Different stories.
So yes, in that area there is a big potential on, and I think cultural heritage would be one of the main assets they have there, and they could build on that. But the guys in Strehaia, this money guy, don't have the know-how how to do such project or what to do with the potential they are sitting on. On the other hand, this Mihai Otto knows how to do, so we could just make them work together.
And he genuinely wants to do the best for the communities.
So yes, it happened.
All the problems he had, it was one of the fact he was Roma, and the other fact he didn't succumb to political pressure. So this political pressure was constant. He never wanted to make the Roma, and that was one of the problems. When there were elections, he never went to the Roma community and told them, you have to vote with that person. So being the interface between the Roma and the mayorship, and he refusing the mayorship to do this, he was constantly attacked and tried to be replaced. So he stood his ground,
mm-hmm.
and he was a very decent person, I believe him. He managed to keep it on. He's too far. Even when we stood there, they told us, because we were there, the electricity was not cut, and they still had access to the internet. So it was a constant abuse of the membership, honestly.
Okay. Good, thank you. So we move to our final presenter. Tania Chilin, is that right? Our guest, I believe, from another project, talking about monitoring hate speech, which sounds very, very, very interesting.
I'm a researcher at Media and Research Center in Bucharest. Some of you are familiar with us and our project, others not so much. Our project is called Less Hate, More Speech. So who we are? We're an independent think tank based in Bucharest. Our main goals are to improve democracy and governance in Romania. Some of our areas of expertise include political representation, political institutions, elections, public opinion, media studies, and so on. A few words about our project. So, broadly speaking, our goal is to explore how different narrative frames, political actors, different media types influence or impact citizens' democratic attitudes. And how we plan on doing that and how we are doing that is through online experiments with citizens, content analysis of online commentary, which is something I will talk about more further on, focus groups with citizens, opinion polls, interviews, and the implementation of a comments moderating system, which again I will talk about. This is a bit of more on methodology. So we are currently we have a survey. We plan on finishing it sometime mid-March. Online experiments, which I won't be talking about in this presentation, but we did that as well. And substantial extensive analysis of comments on media, web pages, and their moderation, including a moderation system we developed for our four partner websites. What you see here is a brief description of one of our key concepts. One of the key concepts in our research, which is the better angels of our nature. This is, we can't really see the notes, I think, but it's a concept brought forward by an English researcher. What this is, well, he calls them better angels of our nature. The researcher name is Blinder. What this means, better angels of our nature, is basically existing anti-prejudice norms in the society. Now, these norms and their salience varies from society to society. For instance, in Germany, they're very, very, very salient. So what these anti-prejudice norms, it's like a little voice on your shoulder telling you, okay, this is not right, what you're saying is not right, it's not, it's offensive, it's, you shouldn't say that. So how we measure that in a survey is through items such as I believe in our society, in today's society it is important that we are not prejudiced, or when I speak to a Roma person it is important to me that I show them I'm not prejudiced towards them. But more than that, so more than the existence of such a norm in society, is what motivates people to adhere to a norm. So what makes people internalize the norm and basically, regardless of the context they're in, what makes the norm salient in their behavior and their speech. And so what we believe and what research has shown is that if the message is not transmitted in the right way, people can disengage from it emotionally and cognitively. So they simply do not, they do not internalize the message, and they do not, they simply brush across it. So it doesn't reach them. So that's why we believe it's crucial to find the right frames and the right narrative that basically reorganized people's thoughts and make other values readily available to them when they're in a situation where they're faced with an outgroup, or people, a person belonging to an outgroup. This is specifically important in situations when you're in an ambiguous situation. I'll talk about this more in the future, because it's very difficult to untangle prejudice from common parlance. One of the key things we'll talk about is how do you separate Roma from Tsigan or Gypsy. You know, is it alright to say Gypsy? Because as you'll see, some people say that okay, it's fine. Well, we don't agree with that. So I'll talk more about content moderation, which is part of our research. It's one of the elements of our research. So as mentioned before, we partnered with four websites. They are Giuseppe.ro, which is a sports news website. Blogsport.ro, which is again a sports news website. Tolo.ro, which is Cătălin Tolontan's blog or website, and he's a known journalist in Romania. And also Pagina de Media, media page, which again is basically a news website. And what these websites allowed us was to implement our own moderation system, our own moderation rules. We basically trained a team of moderators, and we went through all the issues and everything they could encounter in comments, and how they should proceed and how they should go about it, and what should be moderated and why. Now, as you can imagine, this sparked intense debates, both with journalists writing and working for these websites, as well as the moderators, because not everyone agreed why something should be moderated and how it should be labeled. So why a certain comment is labeled as racist or sexist, or you know, again, issues of free speech obviously came into discussion. Prior to our moderation, I'm talking about Giuseppe.ro here because it was the first website we worked with. So they had an automatic moderation. So basically they had a dictionary of bad words contained 162 variations of the word Tzigan because people are very creative and they could use, instead of they could use TZ or you know whatever. So basically what they did was an automatic moderation. So bad words, what they considered to be bad words, were simply moderated automatically. As mentioned before, there was a debate whether to allow the word Tzigan or Gypsy if the rest of the comment was civil. So in the comment, the commenter, the user, the website user had no obvious intention to offend, so he just used the word Tzigan just simply to address the ethnicity. However, what we decided was to replace all instances of the word Tzigan. So if you go on the website today and you try to write the word Tzigan, your comment will go through, but the word will appear with three stars, so the word will not be shown, will not be visible. And we did that referring to a decision made by the Council of Europe. Again, you can't really see the note, but the decision basically said that okay, this term is offensive. It highly depends on the context in which it is used, but it's generally considered to be offensive. After that, some users protested by intensifying their efforts to bypass moderation, so they would again find new creative ways of writing the word, but that didn't help because we have manual moderation, so users manually moderate the words. Others protested the ban, arguing that again it was neutral, it's not meant to offend. The same reactions were stirred among moderators and journalists. They argued that the term Tzigan was a bit excessive, that this should be context sensitive. So we should look at the context in which it appears, not just moderate it automatically. They said one of the journalists said, well, what if the word Tzigan appears in a positive message? So let's say he gave the example of a comment saying, good job, Bonel, you're a cool gypsy. So why do we moderate the word then? It could also appear in a neutral context or a quote when someone is quoting something. Also, they said, okay, maybe Roma is, or they know from experience, that Roma is sometimes used ironically, making it no better than the word Tzigan. Now, they all acknowledge that, generally speaking, the word appears in comments associated with other negative words or bad words, but we shouldn't really sanction or we shouldn't really moderate the word, but rather moderate the whole context and the perception of the overall message of the comment, not simply the word. Now these are a few examples of comments. I translated them into English. This is an example of a comment that we actually moderated. We moderated the word in quote Zigani. So basically, the comment said, good day. What do we do whenever Steaua, which is a football team in Romania, or Romania plays in Eastern Central Europe, we are called Zigani on the stadium. Isn't this racist? Why aren't those teams sanctioned? So you can see this comment was moderated. The word Zigani appears as three stars. So the word was basically... These are, again, two more examples of comments that were moderated. The first one was moderated as being racist. So not only the word Tzigan is ugly, which basically means gypsy, appeared as three stars, but the entire comment was labeled as racist. The second comment does not include the word Tzigan or the word Roma, but it was still labeled as racist because it makes references to the Roma minority. So it says, your club is bankrupt at the matinee and is pulling from Europe for good. Fly away from Chilin minority. We have no old iron. So again, these are examples of comments that end up being moderated. Arguments we use to try to convince the moderators and the journalists that the word is and should be moderated is that it is no longer a neutral term. It is so loaded with negative statements and stereotypes and calls for exclusion that okay, it's no longer neutral. It is offensive regardless of the context in which it is used. We also made the appeal to authority. We said, okay, Roma organizations and NGOs tend to reject the term and say they prefer to be called Roma. We also made an appeal to outside norms. So, okay, some of the moderators said that, argued that, well, gypsies prefer to call themselves gypsies. And we said, well, African Americans can call themselves whatever they like. That doesn't mean that you, as a member of the majority, can make that decision for them. Again, these arguments surprisingly did not work with all the moderators. They were not convinced. They said, okay, I agree that it should be moderated when the whole comment is offensive, but we shouldn't moderate a word simply for calling, simply for identifying an ethnicity. However, one of the moderators later on told us that he did actually went back and asked some of his Roma acquaintances whether they felt offended if they were called Tzigan or Gypsies. And one of his acquaintances, a person who went to the same church with him, said that he did find the term Gypsy offensive, more so because when he googled the word Gypsy or Tzigan, words such as dirty came up in searches and so on. So that was what convinced him. So an argument coming from someone with whom he shared a common identity, going to the same church, but also someone belonging to the minority. What you see here is some results from our quantitative content analysis. So the most common term used to refer to the Roma minority is in fact Tzigan or Gypsy. Among the strongest words associated with this minority group was thieves, character, behavior, trouble, despise, wretch, ugly. So this is what came up from analyzing the comment corpus, so the text of the comments submitted on Giuseppe Datro in the pre-moderation period. The collocations in the text, which basically mean words that often come up in the same comment with the word Tzigan, confirm that, okay, most of the comments containing the word Tzigan are in fact racist and they're prejudiced and show uncivility. For instance, the Gypsy team appeared 16 times in 16 different comments, and it was used as a form of offense towards a particular sports team. Some of the word associations could even point towards calls of exclusion. In quotes, you can see "Strungo Shuttle," which means gather their stuff and basically go away. Threatening eviction or even extermination, there were references to Marshall Leonard Rescue. I'll now talk a bit about an experiment we are currently conducting. Now, if you go on any of these four websites now and you comment, after you submit, so you press the submit button, a pop-up warning will appear, something like this. This is in Romanian, but basically says, your comment is not supposed to offend anyone, even if you don't intend it. Please check if you want to change something. So it basically gives you a second chance to review your comment and decide whether you want to publish it as it is or you want to change something in it, whether it's a few words or whether it is the entire comment. So then obviously you have the option to go ahead and publish your comment as it is, or you can take a few moments and reflect on what you wrote and maybe change something. This is another example of a different preview. Obviously, these previews appear randomly. When you comment, you receive one of our five previews. You only see two here, but this one says your comment should be as polite as you would expect someone to be addressing you on the street. So again, you have the option to publish your comment and or change it. Now, what we expect out of this experiment is that when people get a chance to maybe stop and think for a few seconds, they will maybe remove offensive parts of their comments. However, I played a bit with the data. Obviously, the database is not final. Our project is ongoing. We'll have the final results in 2017. But I played a bit with the data, and it seems to be rather contradictory to what we expected, meaning that actually people who chose comments that people who chose to check to review their comments were more likely to be moderated, which means one of two things: either this preview makes them angry and they say, "Oh, you want me to change my comment, then I'll show you. I'll change my comment. It'll make it even nastier. Or another thing is, obviously people who already have a civil comment will not press the button. They say, okay, there's no reason for me to review my comments, so I'll just publish it as it is now. But people who feel like, okay, maybe there's something bad I wrote in it, I will review my comment. But since they are not very, they're not actually aware of what, which part of the comment is bad. So for instance, the word Țigan, maybe some of these comments were moderated because they contain the word Țigan, but people are not aware that that is a bad word, that will be moderated. So again, it's very difficult for people to understand and to, basically to understand what is offensive, you know? This is something that will affect somebody in the comments, other users in the comments section. As mentioned before, we are currently conducting a survey which contains an experiment. So randomly, half respondents receive questions about the Roma community containing the word Roma. Well, half respondents receive the same question, worded exactly the same, except for the word Roma is changed to the word Țigan. So, for instance, they would be asked, generally speaking, do you like Roma people more or less than other people? While the other half would receive, generally speaking, you like Țigani more or less than other people. Now, what we want to see here is whether simply changing the word, if simply changing the word signals that, so using basically a neologism, changes the way people react and the way people think about their values. So it makes something else, it makes the norm salient in their minds. Because the other speaker, so the person addressing the question, adopts a politically correct term, as opposed to just referring to Roma as gypsies. Again, there is no findings to report at this time because our survey is not completed yet. These are the two potential mechanisms that could work. Basically, simply by using the word Roma instead of gypsy, frames the speaker as an advocate for applying the anti-prejudice norm, and thus making the respondent less willing to express prejudice or negative attitudes. However, the second option is also possible. By using a neologism, the credibility of the speaker is lessened. And people might object to the norms, what we noticed that happened in the comment section. A few conclusions. Yes, prejudice and discrimination exist, but there is also lack of awareness as to what exactly is prejudice, what is a prejudice attitude or a prejudice discourse, or what is hurtful. Simply acknowledging the existence of an anti-prejudice norm may not be enough in guiding everyday attitudes in citizens. What matters is how and by whom these norms are reinforced. So as the example with one of the moderators who was only convinced when a person of Roma ethnicity came forth and brought the argument that he does not like to be called gypsy. Again, our survey and ballot experiments could confirm, because it's not yet confirmed, the importance of wording. And also our comment preview experiment might help us figure out which framings are more likely to make users stop and reflect, because as you saw, the previews the commenters see are different, so they are framed differently. So some receive the preview saying, if your comment does not obey the rules of the website, it will be moderated. So there's a negative reinforcement of the norm. While others said, other previews say, if your comment will not be taken seriously if it contains offensive words. So we appeal to different, we frame this preview differently to appeal to different norms in the users' minds. And that's it.
Thank you very much. This is extremely interesting.
One of them you're using motivation as sugarcoating censorship. Because basically what you're doing by saying motivation is censorship. You are moderating Tigran with 3 stars. That's censorship. My first question, why not moderate the whole comment?
Well, the whole comment is moderated, but if the comment is neutral, the comment is not offensive.
Non-neutral, because if, even if you read the article and have the 3 stars, any racist or any other non-racist will understand that those 3 stars are or Tigan or something offensive. There is not.
Yes, but there is no need to moderate the entire or to delete the comment. That is also an option we have, to delete the entire comment.
Okay.
So we do not do that because we just moderate that word to show that basically we exclude that word from the conversation in the comments thread.
Okay.
But
moderation is censorship. What you are saying is censorship, not moderation.
Well, it is called moderation.
It is an experiment. It is an experiment.
It is an experiment, but what we hope is that the system will continue, and not only that, but it will be adopted by other websites.
Yeah.
I think, I
don't think it's going to work as in loading the awareness, making racist rants, racist comments more moderated.
It's really hard.
They're going to find really horrible ways to go around this.
Yeah, that is currently happening, so they're very creative. They find different words, but...
Basically, the solution for what you're trying to do, I believe, is just deleting the whole comment.
Yes, but some comments, like I said, and as you saw in the examples, are not necessarily bad.
I understand that. But what's the point?
What's the point in deleting the comment? Why would you delete the comment? I think that's worse than just moderating the word and making it basically invisible in the conversation.
I think this is very similar to the word nigger in the United States,
right.
Which is now absolutely has been...
It's an ethnic slur, basically.
Yeah. And that is something that is not. I mean, the African Americans, as you point out, they use it a lot in rap songs and things like that. It's totally different. But in the kind of public speech, it is a word that you just cannot use. I mean, it's like saying shit
It's offensive. We consider it to be an ethnic slur.
I understand what Nick is saying, but I think it makes a difference. I mean, it is simply by pointing out that certain words are not, it makes you think. You do not only think about that word, but also more the whole context. So,
yeah.
I mean, it doesn't solve the problems, that's for sure.
Clearly, and we don't expect to see an impact like tomorrow, but in time, if you see that the word is obviously.
Censored,
yes, so it's basically not allowed. Yes, it is. It's not allowed in public discourse, just like many others, other ethnic slurs, just like many other bad words. They are censored. Yes.
I have a lot of thinking about the Roma and Gypsy issues, especially when going on the field and seeing how interchangeable the two words are for the Roma themselves. But after a while, I decided that for non-Roma and for Romanian society, it's definitely better to use the Roma term than the Gypsy one. It doesn't matter if the comment or the discourse. I myself, I don't think I have anything or any prejudices against them. But I feel like in this environment, it's kind of safe to use the Gypsy or Tsigan. But outside, I wouldn't use it. I mean, even in my private life, or especially in public, I would censor myself and make sure that I'm using the Roma. I think because Romania had a very long, and this is where history comes into it, you know, history is everywhere, of course. And we have a long history of ignoring and, not being responsible with what happened to the Roma in history. And the Romanian society is not responsible with the slavery of the Roma. The Romanian society is not responsible with the Holocaust.
Yeah.
And we would find now references to the extermination and that we should send Țigan to Transnistria in order to make sure no one will come back, and what good Antonescu tried to do to the Romania to get rid of all the gypsies. So this is, and I think the word Țigan is associated with this very long tradition of a certain way of seeing the Roma. And because of that, I think it's simply good. It's not everywhere. Of course, you definitely will not have a result, and probably everybody will hate you for a lot of stuff. But I'm curious, on the other hand, how is the situation on Tolontan's website? I mean, this is sports, and sports fans are probably...
Comments on Tolontan's website are more civil in general compared to Giuseppe and Blogsport.
Because he censors some of them.
He does not censor them, he moderates them. Currently, his website is using our moderation system. And if you go and comment, you receive one of the previews telling you, are you sure you want to publish your comment or you wish to change something in it? I think this what you're saying is perfectly mirroring the debate we had with journalists and moderators. So is it censorship? Is it excessive or is it not? But we're basically signaling that this is not all right, that we won't tolerate any form of discrimination, being even if it's minimal, even if it's just using a word.
Okay, well, why then use in not censoring, not putting two stars or just saying Roma? Why not putting some other word, random word?
Why would we put another word?
Because if you really want to change this by replacing Roma with three stars, Tsigan with three stars or Roma, you're not really changing anything. You're just keeping the same discourse. You're just taking,
no,
you're just making
simply
it a
by not
bit acceptable.
Simply by not containing the word Tsigan, the discourse has changed.
You say that example of Volan, you're from Tsigan,
you're a cool gypsy. That
why don't you say Volan, you're a good footballer? For example, just that.
First of all, because that would give moderators too much freedom, so they can't just go ahead and change comments as they please. But
it would make more sense. And then
I don't think
that
is the right way to go. I think what we're doing is basically signaling, okay, simply the mere usage of this word will not be allowed. And what also this indicates that, okay, there's a reason, there's a norm, you know, that it makes the norm salient in people's minds. There's a reason why this word is moderate. It's not okay for me to...
I agree, but from my point of view, this will not work. You will just keep the rant, the racist ranting going on.
We don't expect to work immediately, but we think
in
time.
Okay.
Thank you. Nonella.
Okay, so congrats for your initiative. Obviously, you will have lots of struggles in implementing it, but I think in the end it's good if you want to raise the red flag about racism and stuff like that. And I wanted to say that there's an NGO in Spain that tried to raise awareness in regards to anti-Gypsyism and racism, and they made this publicity spot in which children, Roma children, had to read the significance of the word gitano from the Spanish dictionary. And basically the word gitano is like, a person who is a thief, a criminal, who does bad deeds, blah blah blah. And they filmed the reaction of the children and they were like, but I'm not like that, my parents are not like that, why are they calling us thieves? My parents are not criminals, we would never harm anyone. So I think it had a huge impact, and I don't know, congrats for your initiative, and probably you should think about something like that also.
Yes, like I said, you know, what matters is the person who's delivering the message. So we could talk to the moderators all day long and tell them this is not the correct term, but until a person belonging to the community came forth and said, I don't like being called a gypsy, and these are the reasons why, because when I Google it, this is what happens, this is what comes up. So it was only then that they were convinced that the norm was internalized, and they were already aware. So these people were not people who were discriminating, they were not prejudiced in any way. But it was only then when the norm was basically extended to include the word gypsy.
Can I
add
something?
The moderator!
About about our field experience. For example, Mulberry. We went into the village, everybody said it was a dangerous gypsy village, community, Indigenous community.
Almost every gypsy community was very dangerous.
Exactly. And we entered the very dangerous community where nothing happened to us. Everybody, there nothing happened. And from my interviews in Mulberry, which was a typical Romanian village, not a gypsy village, a typical Romanian village, I interviewed many gypsies, only one Roma. And others, mostly I interviewed Ion, Gheorghe, Mihai, and names, people. I didn't interview gypsies, I interviewed people. So, they didn't see gypsy as an offensive word. They believed it's really bad that by using Roma, you're not really taking the stigma of gypsy. Because being gypsy is not a bad thing, and it's not disgraceful. It's, I know it's very hard to change this in the Romanian mentality, that's really hard. But this, I don't think it's going to be, from my point of view, I don't think it's going to be a solution.
The gypsy word is heavily ideologically loaded.
Exactly.
As long as it will be used, it will get attached to hundreds of years of history and the way the non-Roma behave toward Roma. And that's it. I mean, yes, we as researchers, we say we are above prejudices and stereotypes sometimes. But to speak outside, it simply, I don't know, gives opportunities for stereotypes to increase. So I mean, I was so furious when I heard a researcher saying that... So complicated, yeah. No. That all Roma neighborhood are dangerous.
Yeah.
Seriously. So is this a relevant characterization of a community ever? Anyway.
Yeah.
Okay.
So the word associated is most often in comments with the word Țigan. So obviously, it's historically so loaded with negative connotations that you cannot say it's a neutral term that you could just use to refer to an ethnicity.
Well, I acknowledge that from perspective of the communities, I mean, it's for many communities, even in Romania, Țigania is something actually what Roma are proud of. This is the Romani hood in their language. So I would plead for not doing that much narrow with the discourse of the last 25 years, but really to see what community now their leaders speak about. I mean, also the word gypsy in Russia, in Russian culture, it's like something adorable, for example. So if we think of loading things with meanings, we should think also about the meaning that communities think about, and also in a wider context, not narrow ourselves. So I really have problems also with the artificial replacing of Roma with gypsies, and at the same time increasing of the anti-Roma stereotypes. So, simply by replacing a word, which is also problematic from the point of view of the community, doesn't solve a problem for me.
No, obviously it doesn't, but what we're saying is, okay, the community has the right to call it whatever they want, whatever they choose. It's about what the members of the majority can say or cannot say, given the historical relationship between Romanians and Roma. So basically that's our argument.
Yeah, I see. It's just not towards your presentation, that's why I didn't raise questions towards the wider discussion, something that I wanted to ask.
I'm sorry, Gelu Duminica is not with us.
Yeah.
Gelu Duminica is a very interesting presentation about the sayings, the folk sayings, including gypsy words in it, like you just te înăcat ca țiganul la mare.
Yeah.
You just drown as a gypsy or near
near the shore.
The shore.
Or a gypsy is human only from afar. Yeah. And
yes, and he has this explanation going back in history where such sayings came from and are highly used by the non-Roma in order to educate the children, for example, and how the word gypsy is simply wrong and people doesn't think of it until somebody is asking a simple question, how that the gypsy drum just before getting to the shore, or you know. And I think from this point of view, just making a sign that there might be something wrong, it's a good start. I don't think it will change everything, and I had a fight with Susanna how our work will change anything. I don't know. I mean,
maybe something.
Yeah, might.
Okay, that's finished. Thank you very much, Tania.